Jackson State has the ball just inside the 10 where they're facing a second and 9. They can get a first down without scoring. And play action. Rutland rolling to his left. The left-hander throws. Incomplete. Defender got a hand in there just in the nick of time. That was Wilborn. Zaire Wilborn, number 26 there.
And Zaire Wilborn has already have a fumble recovery for a touchdown. Here he saves another touchdown because the receiver is definitely open. That first is just good recovery speed. I almost picked that off.
Yeah, you got to get that ball in there a little quicker, to LaVarius Giles, who gets in the receiver and brings up a 3rd and 9 for Jackson State. And we talked about this being the 40th anniversary of that 67 team. W.C. Gordon, who was a longtime coach here. Black titles. Whoa! End of trouble. Boy, I'll tell you, he was lucky Jeffrey Jack was coming that he got that one away. That is the quarterback, Rutland.
Yeah, Jeffrey Jack, he has 2 sacks on the year. He likes to blitz in that strong safety position coming off the backside where the quarterback never sees him. That clock has to start ticking when you have to feel the heat. And luckily, he let that thing go because that would have definitely been a sack and possibly a fumble also.
Eric Perry, the leading scorer in the SWAC, who has kicked a field goal already this afternoon and a couple of extra points. And to attempt this one, will be a 27-yard field goal attempt.
Lines it up.
And the holder is Jimmy Oliver. So do we see a fake here? We doubt it.
I don't think so.
Perry's a pretty good kicker. And he is almost Mr. Automatic. And the 27-yarder is good. And it's a 10-point ball game, 30-20. Still 14:46 remaining in the contest.
Where do you go when you go to bed? Do you go to a place where you can find both rest for your body and peace for your mind? A place where the pressures of the day seem to just melt away? Or is it just a bed? Because if it is just a bed, we'd like to suggest
a pair of field goals today. And he also has a pair of extra points. 12-play, 71-yard drive. The field goal has pulled his team to within 10, 30-20, and Grambling preparing to get the kickoff.
I think that was a good call by Kamaji's taking the 3 points because it was 4th and 9. A lot of coaches would have panicked and maybe went for the touchdown, but you still have a lot more football to play. Still early in this fourth quarter and you're only down 10.
Reggie Jackson feels it and steps. No, he doesn't step out of bounds. The official referee right there on the spot. Well, you're talking about an adventurous day on special teams play today. And why not? Just look at some of the special teams action here. Wide open, running down the field. Reggie Jackson fumbles the ball. And then look at this hit. That stands up, Reggie Jackson. Ball goes loose. Then we have a missed field goal, but they got the reprieve. And then the punt block. We've had all kinds of hijinks here on special teams.
Well, it's been on both sides of the football. I mean, all different aspects of special teams in Grambling State and Jackson State, both teams having their troubles.
From their own 21, completion out the flat. And this is to Reggie Jackson, and Reggie Jackson is out at the 25-yard line, a gain of 4, but we have a penalty marker down.
And I think you're going to have another holding call on one of the Grambling State receivers. That's what it looks like.
Coming into this ball game, when you talk about penalties, Grambling was coming in averaging 61 yards in penalties per contest. Jackson State came in averaging 105.
Holding number 8 of the offense, 10-yard penalty, remains first down.
And that's not a stat you're really proud of. I believe they're the most penalized team in the Southwestern Athletic Conference.
Well, Grambling State has been the team today that has really chewed up the penalty tally because of all of the holding calls they've been getting when they're trying to block on the edge with their wide receivers.
So the holding penalty makes it a 1st and 20. Nothing doing that time as Anthony Atkins was there to make the stop immediately on Cornelius Walker.
Jackson State is trying to do a better job at stopping his running attack by Grambling State in the second half, but they're committing more people into the box, and they're playing man coverage along the outside. So we'll see if their secondary can hold up to this Brandon Landers passing attack. Keep in mind, Clyde Evers has had a big day, and also Reginald Jackson as well.
No gain on the last play, second down and 20. Walker in the backfield with Brandon Landers. In motion is Edwards. Landers standing in there, throwing it long. Almost caught by Reggie Jackson, just off of his hand. He had it. Now, Clyde Edwards would have caught that. Well, we've seen him make some catches.
I tell you what, he would have caught it, especially playing against Jackson State. But this is one that Reginald Landers has to make. And that's just a great job by Brandon Landers of dropping that ball right into the basket. I mean, Reginald Jackson, should I say, should make that catch, especially a receiver of his skill set and the type of plays he's made today.
Leading receiver in the SWAC coming in with 39 receptions, but the man who's put on a display of being a wide receiver is Clyde Edwards today.
I tell you what, if you talk to Clyde, it's not over with yet, Charlie.
He's still putting on a clinic. He's in the slot to the top of your screen. This is a third down and 20. Landers lets it fly, has it complete, out to the 33-yard line, and a first down for Grambling State University. Tim Abney, the tight end, stopped by Malcolm Palmer.
Yeah, and if you don't touch Brandon Landers, if you don't get pressure on him, let him step up in the pocket, he's going to make plays like that. They're playing a two-man coverage, and when you get beat to the inside down the field, that's an easy throw and catch from the quarterback to the receiver, Tim Abney.
The tight end who's in grad school, already has his undergrad degree in business management, at 89 career catches coming in to today's ball game and 7 touchdowns. It is first and 10 at the 35-yard line for the Grambling Tigers. This time it's Warren straight ahead, and Warren for a couple, and that's it. Maybe one. Pogue is there defensively. Neil Pogue.
Yeah, Neil Pogue, and also big Dennis Coit doing a better job of clogging up that middle to stop this Grambling running game. You have to take away something. You can't have a team that's running and passing on. It's almost impossible to stop them defensively. So it seems like they're going to commit to taking away this running game on the early downs and see if they can hold up in coverage on the back end.
Again, Warren is in the backfield. Edwards in the slot to the bottom of your screen. And here is Warren on the carry. And again, Pogue is there to make the stop defensively.
Good job.
Third down and 9. The Pope, successive stops on the running back, Frank Warren.
Yeah, but this has been the problem for the Jackson State defense. They're getting them in third and long situations. You can't get the pressure on Brandon Landers, and he's stepping up in the pocket and making the big throw to complete the play. But we'll see if they bring pressure or they decide to drop back in coverage on this third down attempt.
Here's Landers, throws wide open in the middle of the field. He has it complete to Hills, and Hills is still on his feet. Inside the 10, it'll be first and goal, Grambling State University. LaForest Hills run down by Jeremy Pierce, but not before a big gain on the play for the Grambling Tigers. It'll be first and goal, Grambling.
The guys up front for Grambling are just doing a good job. I mean, they're holding people out, and then the receivers downfield are getting open. They're running these deep in routes. The safeties are too deep for Jackson State, and the run after catch yards are very impressive by the entire Grambling State receiving core.
They'll mark it at the 8. First down and goal. They're waiting for the chains to be moved. Chains were a little sluggish here. They're having trouble getting down the field there.
I tell you what, with all these big offensive plays, I mean, this chain crew is going to be worn out. It's a pretty hot day down here in Jackson.
First and goal, Grambling State trying to stretch their lead. Landers under pressure, throws it, has it complete. At the 5-yard line, and that's as much as they're going to get as Abney, the tight end, makes the reception. It'll be second and goal at the 5.
Yeah, but great play by Jeremy Price for Jackson State because he took away the deep defender and also was able to come up and make that tackle to stop him at the 5-yard line. There goes Brandon Lambert. Man, 309 yards and a touchdown today.
But he also was roughed up a little bit after he let that ball go on that particular play. He's had touchdown passes in every game. He had 4 against Alcorn, 2 against Alabama A&M at Mississippi Valley. He had 2 games when he didn't throw an interception at all. He has thrown an interception in this contest, but it did not lead to any points for Jackson State. Second down and goal. He wants to put it in the air. Beats the tight end to death. It went off the hands of Abney, intercepted by Malcolm Palmer. So that's his second of the day.
Well, Charlie, like you said, he beat the tight end up with the football. And the guy was open. Just give him a nice soft pass so he can catch the touchdown. You don't always have to show off your arm strength as a quarterback. See, he zips it in there. It should have been a catch, needless to say. But you made it extremely difficult for your tight end. And then the ball is up in the air. And Malcolm Palmer and Johnny on the spot. And he's able to make the big interception in the end zone and really save Jackson State. Because if they would have went up right there, I mean, another 7 points on the board. I don't know if Jackson State would have had time to come back from a 17-point deficit.
And it's 10:42 remaining on the clock, so Jackson State gets the ball after the interception in the end zone. Here's a pass out in the flat on the far side. Complete to Jamar Johnson. And Trey Rutland has been in the last couple of series at quarterback for the Tigers of Jackson State. And he completes that one for about 7 yards, where it'll be second down and 3.
Yeah, keep in mind, man, when Jimmy Oliver left this game, he was 14-21, 224 yards and 1 touchdown, no interceptions. So he wasn't playing badly, but Trey Rutland is definitely coming here and giving the Tigers a spark.
Before that play, he was 3 of 9 in the passing department. He's now 4 of 10, and he gets collared trying to run to the left side this time.
And I will say this, as far as the pure passer, Trey Rutland is probably the guy that's probably just a pure passer, where Jimmy Oliver is the better athlete, the better runner. And so if you're behind by 10, 13 points and you realize that you have to pass a whole lot, it's not a bad decision to give Trey Rutland the ball and see what he can do, because he's the guy that can really throw it around down the field.
There you see his numbers now, 4 of 10, 70 yards, Trey Rutland. This is a 3rd and 4. Throws, and they're going to call it a completion. Well, I don't know. I thought they were going to call it a completion.
Well, they're marking the spot. Well, no. Now they're not marking the spot.
Yeah.
Incomplete.
Well, one official came up. I think he was influenced by the coaches on the far side, because the Grambling coaches were emphatic that it was incomplete.
Now, the right foot is out of bounds.
Yeah, he stepped out of bounds and came back in. See, that's what I thought happened on a previous one. So other than that, yes, that is a good call. But he had some help. The line judge had some help. The head linesman had some help from the coaching staff over there. So to bring up a punting situation, they're not able to convert after the turnover, but they did save the touchdown, and they'll punt it from their own 26-yard line. This one goes out of bounds. Right on the Grambling sideline. You talked about Grambling, and we'll talk about their NCAA investigation that occurred back a couple of years ago. We'll be back.
She used to make lunch for us every day. And she put these little...
We're having fun here in Jackson, Mississippi today. 30-20, Grambling on top of Jackson State. First down and 10 for Grambling at their own 40-yard line. Brandon Landers has gone all the way at quarterback. Picked off on the last possession. Here's Warren on the carry. And the stop made by Anthony Atkins. You talk about this Grambling State program. Back in late September, the school was notified by the NCAA that as a result of the NCAA investigation, the institution's football program, it was determined that the 5 secondary violations of NCAA rules that occurred before Rod Broadway got here that occurred between 2000 and 2006 under Melvin Spears' administration, that in as much as the institution's actions in the case were substantial and meaningful, the NCAA was not going to take any further action. Fortunately for Rod Gorka, I'm sure he's happy to hear that.
Yeah, absolutely. You need all of your scholarships.
No question. Second down. And we have a flag. You know, they talked coming into the season about strength of schedule and who had one of the toughest schedules.
Delay a game. Number 7 of the offense. 5-yard penalty.
Grambling was rated 8th in the championship subdivision in terms of having a tough schedule. Of course, they played at Pitt, and then they still have a game against Louisiana Monroe. So they have one of the toughest schedules. One of the other schools on the HBCU side that had a tough schedule was South Carolina State. They played at the Air Force Academy, and they played at South Carolina.
They have a big game against Hampton today.
No question. That's Hampton's homecoming, too. This one passed complete to Abney, the tight end, and he goes down at midfield, but he gets the first down before falling down. So that was a 15-yard completion and picks up the first down. This is what Grambling has done against the championship subdivision team, formerly known as 1AA. 29 points a game and only giving up 12, and is a plus 8 in the giveaway takeaway department. A record of 5-0. Their lone loss came to Pitt. It is first down and 10 at midfield. Brandon Landers. He reminds you of one of those quarterbacks that, you know, he just doesn't do a lot of spectacular things, but he's just as steady as they go, as they say, right?
Yeah, he doesn't make a lot of mistakes. I mean, he's had 2 interceptions today, but the second one, there was one that the receiver should have caught for a touchdown, just a bad break. But I mean, he's a very efficient quarterback. And, you know, only a junior, so he has another year, but he does all of the right things. He really puts his team in position to win, and his receivers do a good job of running after they make the catch.
You're talking about tough schedules this year. Another team that had a pretty tough schedule and doing very well, and their only loss was to Rutgers. That was Norfolk State out of the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference. And they're on top of the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference right now. Second down. This one caught. Not enough for a first down. Defense right there. The catch by Reggie Jackson. Defense right there to make the stop. Hedgman was there defensively for Jackson State. But you look at Norfolk State playing Rutgers this year, Grambling playing Pittsburgh and Louisiana Monroe, South Carolina State played Air Force in South Carolina. Then you have Southern Utah. They probably had the toughest schedule. They played in Montana, North Dakota State, Southern Illinois, McNeese, and Montana State. And they had 5 games against 2006 playoff teams.
Yeah, that's a killer. I mean, you just have to take them one at a time.
Third down. From the shotgun, shuffle pass, that was dangerous.
Incomplete.
It goes incomplete, that was very dangerous, close to being picked off.
Yeah, that's a big third down stop for Jackson State, but you know, we talked with Coach Comegys about playing some of the upper classification schools, Division I schools, and you know, he said it's something that they were thinking about doing because, I mean, it's good for a competition standpoint to measure your guys against, you know, the best in the country, but they also, you're looking at the money you can get by having one of those road games, kind of like when Grambling State travels to a University of Pittsburgh, and they also play Pitt extremely competitive.
Now, the Catamounts of Western Carolina, they didn't have an easy schedule out of the Southern Conference. They played us, yeah, Alabama, Eastern Kentucky, and Georgia. I mean, that's a payday, but I'll tell you, you suffer, don't you?
And Jackson State has jumped offside again, and this will be another first down if that's indeed the call for Grambling State on the 4th and short, and they're in punt formation.
Yeah, once again, they let Grambling stay alive. Here's our referee. Offsides.
And that's so disappointing for Coach Comegys. I mean, for that to happen twice, I mean, you know you're in the 4th and less than 5 situation. What you tell your guys to do is just line up, play defense safe. You're going to put your defense on the field, and all you want to do is just make sure they punt the ball. Watch for the fakes. No one jump offside. That's pretty much the echo up and down the line of scrimmage. For that to happen twice in one football game, it's just pretty much you can't have that.
No, you can't.
Grambling State pretty much did the same thing. What they're doing, they're in the up position, and they go set, and everyone shifts down. And what that is doing is it's jumping off the Jackson State defense.
And a new set of downs for Grambling State University. Now they false start. So now things are getting a little sloppy on both sides of the football.
With 6 minutes and 19 seconds left. Yeah, but 6:19 left in this game and you're down by 10. I mean, to give them another opportunity after you stopped them on third down, I mean, Jackson State, that's just you're killing yourself with that. You just cannot do that. You can't have that penalty in that situation.
No question about it. Here's a pass on the far sideline, and is Abney, the tight end, and he moves the chains. Well, actually, he's not going to get enough for a first down. He's going to be about 3 yards shy as he takes it down to the 31-yard line. Third, make it second down. On the far sideline again, and out of bounds is Abney. So Abney has stepped up to the plate and continues to do the job for Grambling State in the receiving department. The big tight end out of Monroe, Louisiana, went to Neville High in grad school, has his degree already in business management, and came into today's game with 89 career receptions.
Yeah, in Jackson State, now you have a tired defense on the field. You stopped them a couple times, made the mistakes on fourth down. It's tough to have these guys come out here one more time and try to stop this Grambling State offense.
And the ball's on the ground, and Landers just falls on it to save anything else negative from happening. You're talking about losing streaks. We talked about the Aggies of North Carolina A&T. They're playing Howard for Howard's homecoming today at last report. They were leading. They were in trying to break that 23-game losing streak. See what happens.
Good team to break it against those Jay Walkers, Howard Bison.
He won't be too happy, will he?
Not at all. But A&T, I mean, that's a good program. I mean, they'll get that thing turned around sooner or later. But for Howard's sake, you don't want it to be against you.
Nobody wants it to be against you. Like the first team Purdue beat after they lost 70-some games. Here's Grambling running it up the middle and very close to another first down. They're keeping it on the ground and using the clock very wisely right now with Cornelius Walker running the ball.
Well, you have a veteran quarterback like Brandon Landers. He knows how to manage the game. You see the big guys up front running the counter and going downhill with Cornelius Walker. He already has a touchdown on today. And their running game has been very impressive. Now, I didn't expect Grambling to be able to come in here and put up 119 yards against Jackson State. Early in the first half, they really controlled the line of scrimmage. Jackson State has been better later on, but it may be a little too late.
And Jackson State was a team who could run the ball. Walker to the right side. Walker brought down right at about the 11-yard line. And the stop made by Kerry Hoskins, number 25. It'll bring up a first down and 10.
You know, we both talked to both coaches. They both came into this game wanting to know how good are we. I mean, Jackson State, Coach Comagese was excited about the opportunity to play Grambling State because he thought it would be a great test for his team. He thought they were ready. And they played a very inspired game, but just too many penalties and too many mistakes in crucial situations. And Coach Broadway from Grambling State always also felt like his team was ready to play and wanted to test his squad against one of the better teams in the conference.
And he's able to do that. Here again is Walker, and he's brought down at the 9-yard line. You know, one of the things that he also told us yesterday when he talked to Coach Comagese, he didn't want his defense to be overly aggressive and make mistakes and start, you know, making the wrong reads and things of this nature, and play solid defense, don't quit, and you got to stop their backs. And he was concerned about the two freshmen, Walker and Warren. You think about these two young men, they're freshmen, and what they've been able to accomplish this year, they're going to be headaches for a lot of coaches in this conference for years to come.
And you wonder what their career numbers will be like by the time they finish their fourth year, because both of them are very effective, good speedy backs who know how to hit the hole well. And to perform that well as a freshman, you know they're only going to get better.
Walker has the ball. Pogue on the stop defensively.
Pogue has really stepped up his play in the second half. Jackson State has done a good job of course, stopping the Grambling State rushing attack, but they've had to put more people in the box. They had to do some blitzing to stop that, and that is done. It's given Brandon Lathers an opportunity to create some big plays down the field in his second half.
Jackson State played in the first ever SWAC championship game back in 1999. Down in Birmingham, Alabama, they lost to Southern University 31-30. They had guys like Sylvester Mars and Destry Wright on the team back then. Trying to come to the near side. Nothing doing that time. And we got flags. We're going to get unsportsmanlike conduct. Let's see what happens here. Pick number 72 is Muhammad Kareem, junior out of Lincoln High in Dallas, Texas. Do we have offsetting penalties or what? He said, I didn't do anything. Of course, the big fellas never do anything. It's against Grambling.
You know, both of these teams have been highly spirited. You had a couple of unsportsmanlike conduct plays, which you never want from a coach's standpoint. But the effort has definitely been here. They both realize how big of a game this was.
Number 17, 72 of the white team, 15 yards.
Oh, yeah, you see, that was way after the play was over with. And
yeah, he got Marcellus Speaks now. I don't know what Speaks told him on the play before that, but he earned off 15 of those yards right there. You gotta give him a 20-yard penalty for that hit. I mean, those big guys, you have to watch out. And one thing they tell you, hey, don't stand around the pile on defense. If you're not trying to make the tackle, get out the way.
Yeah, Speaks gives up about 70 pounds to Kareem. Speaks comes in at about 230. Kareem comes in at 300 pounds.
Yeah, but in reality, what you do is you hurt your football team, because now you have an extremely long field goal, and it's a situation where it could have been a chip shot. And if you miss this, it's still only a 10-point game. 2:23 left. So
this is a 49-yard field goal attempt by Manuel. His longest that he's attempted this year was a 51-yarder. This one will come from the 39-yard line. It'll be a 49-yard attempt. Kicked three field goals today. Let's see if he can make it four. This one coming from the left hash mark. And it's
a punt. Good call.
Yeah, I didn't think they were going to try to 49-yard field goal. And it goes out of bounds at the 10-yard line. Well, there's a timeout on the field. Just a minute and 54 remaining for Jackson State. They're trailing. Gap, but we've seen a lot of crazy plays in college football this year. A lot of things happening. Here's Landers. He's going to run it. Still on his feet. First down and down at the 29-yard line. A gain of 18 on the run by Trey Rutland.
Well, Charlie, I still think this game has definitely lived up to the hype. We had two undefeated teams in the conference. I mean, a great crowd here, and everyone, I think, has gotten their money's worth. I mean, Coach Eddie Robinson from Grambling State used to always talk about the entertainment value of the SWAC conference, because you definitely have the band and the fans and everything else that goes with the presentation of a SWAC football game is here today.
Now checking the SWAC standing. for our viewing audience. A minute 21 remaining here. Jackson State with the ball, second down and 10. And Trey Rutland gets away from the defense, still on his feet, and somehow maintains his balance and struggles down to the 33-yard line and gains about 2 yards after all of that. It'll be third and 8.
We're not known as a scrambler, but showing some nifty moves, but the time is definitely running out for the Jackson State Tigers. As you see, only a minute and 8 seconds left.
And they call
a timeout. You're
still
down by 10. Yeah. You have to call a timeout just to give your quarterback a breather in that situation.
There you see Rod Broadway on the sideline. He said he's challenged to get this scrambling program back to the level of respect that they've known in the past under Eddie Robinson, Doug Williams, and even Melvin Spears, who did a pretty good job in the first couple of years there. He said leaving North Carolina Central, he felt he left, even though they're moving up and playing as an independent Division I AA or the championship subdivision. He says that he didn't feel he could do any more in that program. And it's always an honor to come to a program like Grambling State University.
I mean, Grambling State, who wouldn't want to coach here? I mean, of course, you have the legacy of Eddie Robinson coaching from 41 to 1997 with the 408 wins. I mean, no one's going to ever top that. I think that'll be a mark that'll stay there. But you still have a chance to cut your teeth and do your own thing. And I think Rod Broadway just has had a great start to his Grambling football coaching career, and have no reason to think that he won't continue going at the pace and that he's set up for himself so far.
Rutland lets it go. This one knocked down by, again, Keith Hall. He's been playing that middle pretty good at the linebacker spot. You know, one of the things we have to give the offensive line of Jackson State a little credit today, I don't believe they've given up a sack today to their quarterback. And in fact, 7 sacks over the last 2 weeks, Grambling has been able to record. They had 3 against Pine Bluff last week and 4 against Mississippi Valley the week before, but they haven't been able to get to the quarterback, although they have put pressure on them.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing with Jackson State from their offensive standpoint, they've done a good job of passing and made some big plays. And Jackson State offense has always been known for making big plays. But their running game has really been the thing that has hurt them today. They came in averaging 149 yards, haven't had that today.
Here comes the sack. Just spoke about it. And finally, they get the big sack. And big number 90 comes in there. That's Kristen Anthony for Grambling State University.
And he leads the team with 7 tackles for loss, 3 sacks, and just coming from the backside, and eventually stand in the pocket and hold the ball. I mean, you have to try to make a play down the field, but Grambling State defense has really stepped up and made some big plays today. They've given up 20 points, but they've played extremely well, and they played tough against the run. And whenever you can make a team one-dimensional that was averaging 149 yards a game, and you shut them down the way they've been able to shut down this Jackson State rushing attack, at that point, all you have to do is stop the pass, and that's very easy. It's not easy to do, but it's a lot easier to do as opposed to when you have a team that's running and passing.
Last year, Grambling came away with a 36-7 victory. Landers had a big game that day, 350 yards, 3 touchdowns. Grambling scored late in the fourth quarter on an interception return. Grambling had 441 yards and held Jackson State to 148 and forced 4 Jackson State turnovers. It was a second straight win over Jackson State. They're going to make it 3 straight, looks like it here today, with the clock going down to 45 seconds.
But you know, one thing that Coach Comegys talked about was the playing with confidence. He wanted his team to play with confidence and play with that Jackson State swagger that these fans have known to appreciate throughout the years. And I think they definitely did that today. They didn't take a step back from Grambling State. They came out swinging, going blow for blow, and they played very hard. They were only down by 3 points at the half. Just a couple mistakes early in that third quarter that opened the game up. But you haven't heard the end of this Jackson State team in this football year.
No, indeed. You know, coming into this game, they said this was the biggest game for Jackson State against Grambling since their win in 85, which started a 4-year winning streak for Jackson State. Well, this is a big win for Grambling State, and this may start something for Coach Rod Broadway. I'm sure he is very, very pleased with what has happened. They've won 7 of their last 8 ball games against Jackson State. Third straight win here today, the final 30-20. And your impressions of what you've seen today?
Well, I'm very impressed, first of all, with this Grambling State's offense. I mean, Brandon Landers was as advertised with the things he was able to do with those two big play senior receivers. But Jackson State played with swagger. We see a lot more from the Tigers.
And to make sure you tune in to ESPN Classic next Saturday, 3:30 Eastern. Minnesota taking on Michigan, ranked 25th in a Big Ten showdown. Coming up next, the 1983 NCAA men's basketball final between North Carolina State and Houston. This has been a presentation of ESPN Classic. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Charlie Neal for Eddie Robinson. Say long, so long from Jackson.